Hey, you know what all the cool kids are into these days? LEDs. You've got them in warm white, cool white, RGB, full color, whatever you want. And once you have some on your 3D printer, not only do they light up your work surface and the print itself, but you can also use them to show some simple status information about what's going on. This is going to work for pretty much any 3D printer. The wiring is super simple and you don't even need to mess with firmware settings to have these LEDs automatically controlled by the printer itself in a somewhat intelligent fashion. So follow along and learn what LEDs I like to use, how to wire them into your 3D printer's control board, and which options you have to make them useful. Let's go! So let's start out with what LEDs make sense for us here. You're probably going to be powering these LEDs from your printer's built-in power supply. They don't add a ton of load, so unless you've got a power supply that's already struggling, or you're trying to add an obscene amount of LEDs, you're probably going to be fine. The LEDs most of you will think of are probably these LED strips. They're a centimeter wide, they're flexible, and have some double-sided sticky tape already applied on the back, so you can just stick them anywhere you want, bend them around corners, or even wrap them around aluminum profiles, or in this case, around a 3D printed part. The LEDs themselves are these little guys right on here. You can get them with different brightnesses, different shades of white, or in any other single color, and of course, in RGB, which is basically a red, green, and a blue LED combined into one, and you can control each color individually. So the common LED strips are a good choice. They are incredibly cheap. You can get a 5 meter long spool for just a few bucks, and you can cut that into smaller sections every 3 LEDs. Even though the sticky tape on the bag does adhere well when you stick them on initially, I do like to add a dab of hot glue or super glue to the ends to keep them in place permanently. Another type I also really like are these LED rings. They're originally intended to get that tacky BMW angel eye effect on your car, but because you can get them in different sizes, you're going to find one that is the perfect size to fit around your hot end. These come as a rigid PCB, so you don't have to worry about mounting too much. You can, of course, make a 3D printed adapter to fit stuff perfectly, but you can also just epoxy or zip tie them to your carriage. These have a nice even light that highlights details as they are being printed, but you should definitely not pick a ring that is much too large, since that will light up everything around your tool head, but leave the very center in the dark. Now, these two options run off of 12 volts, so they're somewhat specific to this use. Another option I kind of like are these basic LED spots. They come in the shape of a halogen spot, and these work really well if you have your 3D printer in any sort of an enclosure. You drill a few holes, pop them in, and basically hook them up like any other light fixture. It's a different approach. I really like the look of these, but you know, just to throw it out there, there are always different options. Now, how do you wire up the LED strips and rings? The simplest way would be just to head over to your printer's power supply, add a pair of wires, and connect that straight up to your LEDs. If your printer is using a 24 volt supply, which is somewhat common on nicer machines, you will need to add a small buck converter in line that will drop the 24 volts to 12. Basically, you hook up the input side to the power supply, adjust the potentiometer on them until the output has exactly 12 volts, and then connect the rest. So hooking up stuff directly might be perfectly fine. As soon as you switch on the printer, the LEDs are going to come on as well, but you can go quite a bit further. If you just want a simple switched LED that is on when the hot end is hot, so when the machine is actually working, you can try and see if your printer has a switched hot end cooling fan output that turns off when the hot end is cold. Don't confuse that though with the part cooling fan, that's different. Usually the output for the hot end cooling fan has a bit of extra capacity, and you could wire some LEDs directly into that output in parallel with the fan. It's not really elegant though. So what you can do instead for full control is to use a spare pin that's routed out somewhere on your control board. You should be able to find a graphic like this that shows which physical exposed pins correspond to which Arduino pin numbers. You can use both so-called digital pins that either only have a number or are called D12, D13, etc. or the analog pins, should there be any spares. They are always called A1, A2, and so on. On the ramps, you have all these pins up here. On the RAM bow, there is this extension header. The MKS base has a few pins next to the end stop connectors, and on many boards you can even use the unused end stop connectors themselves or the pins on the LCD connector to get a few extra control signals. But if you do that, keep in mind that the firmware might already be configured to use those signals for their original purpose, which means we cannot easily use them for other stuff. Your best bet is always to use spare pins that are otherwise unused. Now, these pins are directly connected to the microcontroller, so they can't drive any significant load by themselves. Instead, you'll need to add some sort of a driver module. Of course, you can use the classic Arduino relay module if you fancy that clank every time it turns on or off, but since we're only switching DC current with the same ground reference as the control board, a MOSFET does the job much better. Well, of course, you can use a bare MOSFET or even a bipolar transistor. Using one of these ready-made boards gives you all the circuitry and screw connectors and like 50 cents each. I'm going to be using this homemade board from a few years ago, which does the exact same thing. You connect your spare pin from the control board to signal, a spare ground to ground. You can also grab ground from the power supply if you don't have an extra one on the board, and then wire in your 12 volt supply on the input and the LED on the output side. The RGB strips only have a single positive line, so you only have to hook that up once, but you do have to connect each individual color line to the negative output side of a switch module. And that's the hardware done. Now, actually, you can right away try out if the hardware is working by sending a single line of G-code to your printer. That line is M42, P, then the pin number used, and S255. If you used an analog pin, you'll need to get the according digital pin number according to this table. And as a bonus, try the same thing with S126. If your pin can do pulse width modulation, the LED should now be at just below half brightness, and you'll be able to dim it using any value between 0 and 255 for the S setting. If the LED turned off completely, then that pin can only do on or off, which honestly is still fine. Now, if you're not getting any reaction from the LEDs at all, double check your wiring first, and if that doesn't help, maybe try a different pin. So, we've got full control over the LEDs through the firmware now, which is great, but how do we make them smart? Some firmwares like Smoothieware let you define conditions when the printer should turn on or off certain things, but we're just going to weave in the controls into every print's G-code. It's simple, it's automatic once it's set up, but there are a few things to watch out for. For the simplest implementation, we're going to use the start and end G-codes. But of course, you can customize this however you want it, like if you have two extruders, have the printer light up differently for each one. But to start out, we're going to head into the start and end G-code settings of your slicer. Depending on how many LEDs you hooked up, you've got a ton of different options. I'm just going to walk you through what I'd set up for a ring light on the tool head and some RGB LED strips somewhere else, illuminating the rest of the machine. At the very start of a print, I want to indicate that the printer is preparing and heating up. So I'll add M42P, then the pin for the red part of the RGB strip, S255. And the same thing for the green, to mix yellow light. Just to be sure, I'll also add the G-code to turn all other lights off. Then you'll have the homing and auto-leveling parts of the startup, and once that's done, I want to switch it to a pure red. Now, the important thing is to add an M400 line before our next lighting-related G-code. Because of some wacky logic, Marlin doesn't always run G-code one line after another, but might run some stuff in advance as soon as it's stored in the buffer, and the M400 will just say, okay, before you run anything after this, make sure you are done with everything else. And that includes homing or heating up. So, M400, then M42P, pin for green, S0 to turn it off. Then we'll have the M190 line, which pauses until the heated bed is hot, if you have one, and M109, same thing for the hot end. So once those lines are done, the printer will start the actual print job, and for that, I just like to have a nice white light on the entire machine. So another M400, just to be sure, and then an M42 for the LED ring, the green, and the blue parts of the strip, and you're in business. Now, once the print is done, we can actually use the LEDs to tell us when the print bed is cold enough to remove a part. So what usually works is this. You let your printer run whatever moves it does to move the bed forward and the printhead out of the way. And then we first set the LEDs to, for example, green, and then blue once everything is cool. So first off, turn everything off but the green LEDs. then use M190, R25, or 30, and by using the R instead of what would usually be an S, and then the temperature, the printer now waits for the bed to cool down as well, usually just waits for it to heat up. Now, another M400, so at this point the bed is guaranteed to be at 25, 30, whatever degrees Celsius. Now we're doing the M140S0 to turn it off all the way without waiting, and your M42s to turn off green and turn on blue. If you want, you can also add a timer until the LED then shuts off on its own. That is G4S, and then the time in seconds, M400, and then the M42 to turn off whatever LEDs are still on. So this is what the entire thing looks like now. Even without an LCD, we get a ton of information on what the printer is up to, and you'll never have to take out your phone as a flashlight again to get a better look at how your print is going. Again, all the material for this are linked in the video description below. It's all pretty cheap stuff, so if you're looking for a quick project that'll make your 3D printer cooler and more usable, give it a go. And if you're running into trouble during the process, check out the forums at discuss.toms3d.org. Right up here, I think that's the exact type of help and advice the forum should be ideal for. If you found this video helpful, give it a thumbs up, get subscribed to see more like it, and if you feel like directly supporting the channel, head over to Patreon to get access to monthly hangouts and more. That's it for today. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.